Today, let's take a really quick look at anti-aliasing, specifically WebGL's built-in multi-sample anti-aliasing. I'm adding this to this mini-series on framebuffer object techniques not because anti-aliasing is somehow limited only to framebuffer objects, since that's not true, but because you'll almost never have problems with it except when you start using framebuffer objects. So, if you ran the code in my last video on variable Gaussian blur, you may have noticed this. When you set the blur radius to 1, so no blur at all, the output looks jaggy. And yeah, if we render the geometry straight to the canvas without using a frame buffer object and compare the results, for some reason we used to have anti-aliasing, but now we don't. But it's a blur filter, right? So who cares? If there's no blur, if only for performance, just remove the filter. But remember the video on deferred lighting? Before adding frame buffers and after. So yeah, once you see it, it's pretty brutal. And this is always going to happen whenever you render geometry to texture, so anytime you use regular frame buffer objects. So, in the rest of this video, we'll do a lightning-fast explainer on the basics of multi-sample anti-aliasing. We'll see how this feature is handled more generally in WebGL2. We'll look at what you have to do to get it working with frame buffer objects. We'll learn all the new instructions and syntax. We'll try it out and update the deferred lighting example from before. And last, we'll look at some of the downsides of this particular kind of anti-aliasing so that you'll know if it's a good fit or a bad fit for your project. I don't think I need to explain what aliasing is or why we don't like it, but it's worth talking about how it happens because it will make multi-sample anti-aliasing make much more sense. Say we have a black triangle on a white triangle with no anti-aliasing. Let's zoom in on this edge here. This pixel is white because it's covered by the white triangle, but not the black one. This one is black because it's covered by the black triangle covering up the white one. Why is this pixel white, though? Well, you could say it's because the black triangle doesn't cover most of it. But in computer graphics, we want things that are super easy to calculate. So instead, we just look at the center of the pixel and see if that sample point is inside or outside of the triangle. In this case, it's outside of black, but inside of white. So it's white. The end goal of anti-aliasing will always be to smooth the transition so that high contrast diagonal or oblique edges don't leap to new pixel columns or rows so suddenly like this. And it does that by introducing smooth gradients that soften the transition. There are lots of ways to do this, but the way multi-sample anti-aliasing does it is by adding new sample points to each pixel. The exact pattern of these points vary by hardware, but let's take this four sample pattern as an example. Now you'll see that one of the four samples is inside the black triangle while the rest are not, so the black triangle should contribute a quarter towards the pixel's final color. This one has two samples inside, so it contributes half, and so on. The real power of multi-sample anti-aliasing is getting all this extra detail, but still having the fragment shader run only once per pixel, if possible, rather than once for every sample. Now, the way this is done is surprisingly complex, but for us, that's about all we need to know. We get gradations due to whether our geometry is inside or outside our little sample points, and those nasty little jaggies mostly vanish. Like I mentioned at the beginning, you don't have to have multi-sample anti-aliasing in your regular WebGL2 applications. You get it by default, but you can easily disable it when you create your WebGL2 rendering context. This takes an optional configuration object. If you specify anti-alias false, it'll be disabled. Set it to true or don't say anything, and WebGL will leave it enabled. Why would you want it disabled? Well, this feature does come with a performance penalty, not a huge one, but it is measurable, and sometimes there's literally no reason to have it on at all. You basically only need it if all of these three conditions are true. 1. You're rendering geometry with visibly obvious oblique edges. So this diagonal edge is fine because it's part of a quad, but now it's not because the edge is visible. 2. Those edges also produce areas of high contrast. So this is probably okay because that edge doesn't stick out too much, but now it's not okay because it's so obvious. And three, you're not exclusively producing ultra-high resolution output, so 8K is okay, 4K is probably okay, but anything below that, if you can make out individual pixels, it's not okay. And that's pretty much it. But if at the end of your project you're not sure, just try disabling anti-aliasing. If you notice a difference, undo. If you don't, leave it off. Okay, but what if we're using framebuffer objects? There, anti-aliasing just removes itself for no apparent reason. How do we fix that? Here, it's not quite as easy, but it's nothing crazy. Say this is our current setup. We have a geometry program. We issue its draw call. Its output gets sent to one or more textures attached to a framebuffer object, plus maybe a render buffer for depth or stencil testing. Then in a second program, we paint that texture to a full screen quad, maybe with some kind of post-processing effect, and send it out to the canvas. Pretty basic. Well, in a nutshell, all we're going to do is inject another framebuffer object here. It will be structurally identical to the first one and take over all of its responsibilities, but it'll be configured for multisampling. We'll draw our geometry to that, and then we'll convert and copy, or blit, the multisampled contents over to our original regular textures in our original regular frame buffer. And that's it. Nothing else changes, except we lose those annoying jaggies. The good news is that there's only a few API instructions to learn. Previously, we created textures and allocated memory for them using TextStorage2D. And for depth and stencil testing, we allocated space for render buffers using render buffer storage. Now, we'll be using render buffers for everything. And to make them work with multisampling, we'll only ever allocate space using render buffer storage multisample. This is a new instruction, but it has virtually the same syntax as render buffer storage. The only difference is that we need to specify how many samples to use per pixel. In this video, I'm going to hard code it with 4, but you should always query WebGL for this value. I'll explain why in a second. Also, when allocating space, you need to make sure that width, height, and sample count are all the same in all the attachments, including depth and stencil attachments. No mixing and matching, otherwise you'll throw. Then we'll create a new frame buffer object, just like before, bind it, just like before, and attach these render buffers, just like before, using frame buffer render buffer. Previously, we only used this instruction with depth attachment, stencil attachment, or depth stencil attachment. Now we'll also use color attachment 0, color attachment 1, and so on for our color data, just like we did when we were attaching textures. Now, let's go back to the sample count. You're free to pick a value depending on your tastes. Some hardware supports 8, 16, or even more samples per pixel. The most widely supported value seems to be 4, but it's important not to request more samples than are supported, or you'll throw. And that maximum value varies by device, so how do you know what value to use? By far, the simplest way is just ask WebGL with this. But what if you're looking for more choice? This tells you all of the available sample sizes supported by a device for a given storage type. I get 1, 2, and 4 on my Android, but only 2 and 4 on my Mac. Also, once you've specified a sample size, the device is still free to ignore you and pick its own. For example, on my Mac, if I try to use 1, it'll default to 2. You can always check what value you're actually getting using this. But what this really boils down to is this. It's normal to expect 4 samples per pixel on almost any modern device, but you should query WebGL and round down to the device maximum if that's not available. Now that all the setup is done, let's look at the render loop code. Here, before we make our draw call, we need to bind our new multisample frame buffer so that the output gets sent there, and draw. That was easy. So last, we need to convert and copy all the color data from those multisample render buffers to our original textures. To do that, we call blit frame buffer. But before we do, Where's the data coming from? And where is it supposed to go to? We have two very similar frame buffer objects, and WebGL has no idea which is which. Plus, there may be multiple color attachments, so we have to be very specific. First, the frame buffer objects. Previously, when we bound a frame buffer, we always used the target frame buffer. Now, to specify a frame buffer as a source for blitting, we bind using read frame buffer. And to say that it's the destination, we bind using draw frame buffer. Next, the color attachments. Do you only have one? Good, you're done. If not, read buffer specifies the source attachment, so this will read from color attachment 0 in the source frame buffer. And draw buffers specifies the destination. And yes, this is the same instruction that we learned earlier, and it still has the same annoying syntax rules. This sends the output to color attachment 0, 1, 2, and so on. It is technically possible to specify more than one attachment here, and it will copy the data to all those attachments, but you'll typically only want to specify a single attachment here each time. So now, finally, we can look at blit frame buffer. The first four numbers define the rectangle of your source that you want to copy. Typically, this will go from 0 to the pixel limits of your output, but you're free to copy only a portion that you're interested in. The next four are the same, but define where you want that rectangle of data to go in your destination texture. Next, we say what kind of texture data we're copying, but since we're copying to textures, this will basically always be color buffer bit. And last, if our source and destination frame buffer objects have different dimensions, we specify what kind of interpolation should take place, linear or nearest. If our source and destination frame buffer objects are the same size, though, just use nearest. And remember to always unbind when the blit is complete, but before the next draw call. If you leave them bound, WebGL will complain of a circular reference and throw. So now we have the syntax we need, let's take it for a drive with the deferred lighting example. You can find this in this video series GitHub repo. Just load this code into a page anywhere after a 480 by 480 pixel canvas, and you should be good to go. We're not going to review this code here at all, we'll just jump right in. The application's only frame buffer object is generated in the function called createFrameBufferObject. It currently only returns a single frame buffer object. Now let's return an array of two frame buffer objects. And let's just completely duplicate the old texture frame buffer object code that's there now, since that'll help us write the new code. Our texture is now a render buffer, which we need to create. No more texture, so remove active texture, bind. No more text storage 2D, instead we'll use render buffer storage multisample. The target is frame buffer. Hardcode 4 samples per pixel. Internal format will be the same as before, RGBA 16F, and the width and height will be the same as well. And do the same for the other texture as well. There are now two depth buffers, but we only need this one because this will be attached when rendering the geometry. But let's make it clear it's for multi-sample anti-aliasing, and give it the right storage, with 4 samples per pixel, just like the others. Create a new frame buffer object for these attachments and bind it. First, attach the position render buffer. Instead of frame buffer texture 2D, we use frame buffer render buffer. The first target is frame buffer. This is for color attachment 0. The render buffer target is render buffer. And last, we specify the render buffer itself. Do the same for the normal render buffer. It's at color attachment 1. And remove the old depth buffer, since we won't need depth testing when rendering the quad. And we're done creating stuff. So finally, the render loop. We want to draw to the new multi-sample frame buffer object, so bind that and draw. At this point, its render buffers should be full of multi-sample color data. So now, before we draw the quad, we need to convert and copy all that color data to our textures. First, we'll be reading from the multi-sample frame buffer, so bind read frame buffer for that. And we'll be writing to the original frame buffer, so bind draw frame buffer for that. and unbind both at the end. To copy, we use blit framebuffer. The source size is 480 by 480, so that'll be our source rectangle, same for the destination. It's for copying color data, so we use color buffer bit. And nearest, because the source and destination are the same size. But where from and where to? If we're blitting the position data, we'll read from the multi-sample frame buffer object at color attachment 0 and draw to color attachment 0 on the regular frame buffer object. And the same for the normal data, which are both at color attachment 1. Notice that I have to put none before color attachment 1 here. And we're done. And it looks pretty. Well, let's just say that it looks better. But as a matter of taste, I think it looks pretty good. But let's talk about some of the problems with multi-sample anti-aliasing to understand why there might be some problems specific to this deferred lighting application. Before I go on, I just want to emphasize that there are lots of examples where this kind of anti-aliasing works really well. It's fast, it doesn't chew up a ton of resources, plus it's supported at the API level, so it's really easy to pull off. It kind of should be your first choice. But it's no magic bullet, and there can be some serious downsides for certain types of renders. Understanding this can prevent you from potentially wasting a lot of time and effort. Let's start with this one because it's really instructive. If one of your color attachments is an integer buffer, like we had with our object picker video, you can't use it. WebGL will throw if you try. So if you have object picking, you have to put up with jaggies? Not exactly. What you have to do is two draw calls. One draw call will save the integer data without anti-aliasing to a regular frame buffer and a regular texture, and the other will draw the visible color data with anti-aliasing to another frame buffer object. Or don't use a frame buffer at all for that second draw call. Just dump it straight to the canvas and get anti-aliasing from WebGL by default without lifting a finger. Okay, so wait, you may be thinking. If integers are the problem, why not just use a float, right? This is a great question because it gets to the real, actual heart of the problem. Imagine this is one of our pixels. One half is covered by a triangle with an ID of 1. The other half is covered with a triangle with an ID of 9. When WebGL mixes this down to a single ID value, what should that be? I would be fine with 1 or 9, but if WebGL decided on 5, would you be okay with that? Probably not, but that's what WebGL would do here. The issue has nothing to do with the technical limitations of WebGL, it's a broader idea of what we want anti-aliasing to actually do. Next example, because this happens for floating point color data too. In fact, I chose the deferred lighting example today because it illustrates this problem too. What you see depends on the device, but along some edges, you will probably just barely make out some pixels that are reflecting too much light. You might also see the occasional firefly. This is because we're anti-aliasing position and normal data, and when we do this during multi-sampling, in effect, we're creating new geometry that isn't there, melting objects together when they shouldn't be, and causing light to be reflected in ways that it shouldn't. Is this a problem? It depends on what you're rendering, so really it's your call. You could go to a different anti-aliasing algorithm like supersampling or fast approximate, but it depends. Personally, in this case, I don't know. On the one hand, it's incredibly subtle, so fixing it might not be a good use of my time, but it does bother me. So honestly, I don't know. Finally, last caveat. It's also possible to get aliasing artifacts inside your primitives as a result of contrasting texels in your textures. In this case, multi-sample anti-aliasing will do nothing, and your only option is to rethink your textures or use another anti-aliasing algorithm. In any case, the good news is that even if multi-sample anti-aliasing doesn't work out in the end, it's easy to try and find out for sure. But remember, for many, many projects, it's a perfect fit. It's fast and light, and it's built into WebGL, so try it out. So that's it. In the next video, I'll probably do Bloom, and maybe we'll find out if multi-sample anti-aliasing is a good fit for that. See you then.